Hey everybody, Jake Reichbart here. Today I'm going to share with you a lengthy lesson excerpt. So have your guitars ready and we're going to have some fun together arranging a song. Perhaps you've seen some of my many hundreds of solo guitar arrangements I have here on YouTube, and the inspiration for these arrangements is right here behind me, as you can see. I grew up with these vinyls, and I draw pretty much from any kind of style imaginable. From the pop music of the past 100 years, everything from Glenn Miller to Van Halen, Alan Holdsworth to Motown, and pretty much anything in between. Beatles, I have perhaps 25 Beatles song arrangements, 20 Steely Dan song arrangements, same for Stevie Wonder, rock, hard rock, Deep Purple, Led Zeppelin, and of course tons and tons of classic jazz standards from the 40s and 50s, bebop, dance tunes, movie themes. And if you want to learn how to arrange any of these songs for solo guitar, I can teach you. Just like the excerpt that you're about to watch, which comes from a lesson that runs about 90 minutes, I have nearly 200 additional titles, and they are mostly song specific. I enjoy teaching through specific songs because I can show you hands-on how I approach arranging a song. What's nice about these lessons is that I don't just tell you, do this and you're done, but rather I'll take you through three or four or five different ways to play the same passage. I'll work with you on dynamics, on articulation, and 100 other things that you cannot just put to paper. As I mentioned, these lessons run approximately 90 minutes. The introduction, which runs usually 15 minutes, focuses on the right hand and rhythm. And in this introduction, I go through my three pillars of rhythmic arranging, the first principle being melody and bass only, the second being rhythmic arpeggiation, and the third, of course, the down stroke that I play with my right hand fingernails to produce that backbeat that everybody asks me about. Nevertheless, I do have two main method lessons. The first one, how to arrange any song for solo guitar, running 2 hours, and also an introduction to fingerstyle guitar and solo guitar arranging, running 2 hours and 40 minutes. The information about these lessons, the cost, my full lesson list, as well as a link to the full performance of the song that we're working on today, is below in the information. So expand the information, take a look, and let's get started. The tune, of course, starts with a famous introduction that, for some reason, a lot of the bands that I play with have a hard time with this, and they just skip it. But I decided to keep it because I think it's kind of signature to the song, and it's nice to be able to know. As I mentioned in the introduction, it would have been a lot easier to do it in E, because for sound you get a nice big fat E at the bottom, and also for gripping wise it's easier to play these four notes than these five notes together. But nevertheless, I decided to do what I had to do and play it in F, so that's what it is. But once again, if you decide you want to change the key, and especially if you wanted to lower it to E, you'll get a lot of open strings available to you. At any rate, we start the arrangement with this position in this grip here in the 13th position, I should say. It's a bar on the 13th fret. And at the outset, this is essentially an F13, that's to say an F7 with a 13 in it. It's kind of the sound that I hear in my head anyway. And as I said, it's a bar on the 13th fret, so you get from the bottom, you get the F on the 6th string, E flat on the 4th string, nothing on the 5th string, 3rd string, the A, which is the 3 against the F. Then your 13 is the D on the 2nd string 15th fret, and the F melody on the top on the 1st string, again 13th fret. And you play the five notes together. And then you play these three notes. And when I do that, I notice that sometimes I'll manage to keep the chord in place, which is kind of musically more of a, you know, a more appropriate way, or you sustain the bass note. But in the heat of the moment, and if it's hard, you can also let go of the chord and just play these three notes. It's your choice, really. I don't think it's the end of the world if you play the chord and make the harmonic statement, then play the three notes, and then play the next chord. It's not like, oh my God, what's the harmony at that split second that you play only these three notes? So either way works. So what are the three notes? They are the E flat on the second string, 16th fret, pull off to the C. So obviously we'd let go of this D by now. If viewing it this way, it's actually a four note phrase starting with the F, but we already played the F with a chord. So we play this chord with the F on top and follow it with E flat, C, and B flat. And the E flat and C are on the second string frets 16 and 13, and then the B flat on the third string 15th fret. Here it is while holding it down. So you can hear that this note keeps sustaining, and that's cool. Or you let go. Either way works. The next melody note that we're aiming at is the C, but via two notes. This bluesy slide from the G sharp into the A and then C. Now that's just the melody sliding, and there's no reason for the whole chord to be sliding. But really, I haven't found another way, maybe it didn't look long enough, another way to just slide the note without the rest of the chord. And I thought, well, this is the easiest way for a lazy person like myself. And in fact, in full disclosure, what informs a lot of what I do is laziness, going for the easiest thing that works. And I make that's a full confession that I'm making here. Sometimes I find that those lazy things actually work out quite well. So thing is, we're not dwelling on this chord. It's not that we're playing this chord and this chord. It's that we're playing this chord, but sliding into it. So we're not, it's not really a change of harmony. And it seems to work, and I'm kind of satisfied with that. Not sure if it's worth trying to find another way to do this. It seems to be working. So what is the chord? The chord is still an F, but with A in the bass. The idea is, it's that movement. It's a device. It's a harmonic device. How to take what is basically an F7 for a while and just kind of lifting it up. And that is done by playing the three in the bass. So again, an easy shape to grab. So doing it from the F, starting with this position, it's a bar on the fifth fret. I play the A, nothing on the fifth string. Also the G, which is the ninth. The C, which is the 5, F, which is the 1, the root of the chord, and A. And then, while holding it down, just adding the C. Now, I mentioned that I'm sliding into it, so basically it's the same shape exactly on the 4th fret. I don't know if it's even worth mentioning the notes, but I'll say them anyway. G sharp, F sharp, B natural, E, and G sharp. Play the entire chord, slide it into place, and then add the C. So together, and after I played this, you'll notice that I have just a little time to arpeggiate because the rhythm is already starting. Next phrase. kind of a parallel phrase now, but the harmony changes, goes now to a B flat 7. If I wanted to play it like a ninth, I could have played this shape, which you're still welcome to do. I didn't bother with it. You can play it like this. So what I did do was simply this. It's a finger in the same position, the 13th fret that we'd done before, but now I play the B flat in the bass and just the three notes on top, which are the B flat, C, and F. And then those same three notes again. E, C, and B flat. And again, you can try to sustain this if possible. A little tricky, but not impossible. This is a B diminished. So the chord shape without the little melodic movement has the B on the 6th string, 7th fret. My first finger holds two notes on the 6th fret. They are the G sharp and the F on strings 4 and 2. Again, like I said, on this 6th fret. My third finger also plays on the 3rd string, 7th fret, the D. That's the chord by itself. But my pinky is responsible for a little melodic movement. Very bluesy. And that's an A flat to G, F, and back to G. So, one more time. The third segment, and we're going to go over all of this again, but the third segment now of that introduction is a little bit of a stretch. It's hard to play, but go slow. This is an F again, and I decided to play C in the bass. It's what I hear in the recording, but it follows that bass line. That's basically the bass notes of the introduction. So it's an F, but with C in the bass. And the way I play it, which is a bit of a stretch, is play a bar in the eighth position. I have the C with my first finger. My second finger now plays the F triad, which are three notes in the 10th fret, C, F, and A. And my pinky now reaches up to the F. And the familiar melody, but now played differently. This thing, but now played here because I'm holding down a shape in this position. So after I played this, I can let go because I already stated the harmony and don't have to. I could do that. Seems like a lot of work, and I'm working pretty hard already, so. So I play the same melody, the familiar melody, but in this position, and that is to say E flat. And C now on the first string, frets 11 and 8, and then the B flat on the second string, 11 fret. Same idea with the slide now. But with the chords D, 7, D flat 7. with a little melody on top. So I start by playing this very basic shape of a seventh chord. I'm aiming, like I mentioned before, for this D7, and this D7 in the 10th fret will have the notes D, C, F sharp, and A. It's a bar chord, but I slide into it, and then I add the E flat on top, or the D, well, I'll call it an E flat, because it's a flat 9. So this to this, add this E flat, and similar movement here, sliding from the C7 to the C-sharp 7, which is the same chord exactly, but now in the 9th position, 9th fret. So the notes are C-sharp, B, F, and G-sharp. Yep. And the melody is the G, G-sharp, and C-sharp. And when I get to the C, I play it as a C13, which is exactly what we did here in F. But now in the 8th position, so the notes are C, B-flat, E, A, the 13th, and the C on top. And I do kind of a slide back and forth. Again, because I think in my mind I'm hearing this in the original recording. I'm not 100% sure it's there, or maybe it's something similar. And this goes to a larger point about my particular mind as a filter. I hear things in a certain way, and when I play them, it's not like I play a guitar arrangement. In my mind, the way I work anyway, is that I play a song, and in my imagination, I am the song. I am playing what the band is playing. Not every song, but I'd say 80% of my arrangements are like that. And therefore, when I play, I try to do things that I think are happening in the original recording. Whether this is true or not, that's a whole other story. But it seems to me that some things are happening. And for the most part, I seem to, from the feedback I get, this seems to work pretty well. But again, the more important point here is that you need to also use your mind as a filter. So while I'm giving you all these little trills and little things that I think are the things that I hear in the recording, don't let that stop you from playing things that you hear in the recording, or to not play things that you think I'm playing that are not representative of the recording. So that's just a little point about the mind as a filter. And now the vocal melody is about to start. So I will play now the entire introduction very slowly. And a little arpeggiation. So I didn't play that quite in time. I want to take a little extra time to kind of emphasize every fingering and voicing. So now I'll try to do it more accurately in time.